In this chapter, you will be studying the chemical structure and function of carbohydrates, plus related topics such as dietary fiber, the glycemic response, and hormonal control of blood glucose levels. Before you begin your studies, I just want to provide a bit of background information and emphasize a few things that are important related to carbs and nutrition. First, as you will quickly learn, carbohydrates are polymers. That means that they're chains of a basic monomer. In this case, the monomer is called a monosaccharide, or more commonly, just sugars. Sugars are typically 5 or 6 carbon molecules. When you put them in water, such as in a living organism, they form rings. So when you see the chemical structure, the ring is typically what you see. Oftentimes, that ring is even shortcutted with no actual atoms. I remember when I started out in the field before I took biochemistry, I didn't really understand that. So the point is, when you see these rings, think sugars, and if they're put together in a chain, think carbohydrates. In the digestive system chapter, we looked at the chemistry of breaking bonds. So, for example, amylase in saliva breaks the bonds between glucose molecules in starch. Now let's look at making those bonds. If we take 2 sugar molecules and remove a water molecule in a chemical reaction called condensation, or dehydration synthesis, we can make a disaccharide. Look closer at that chemical bond. We can make an alpha-glycosidic bond, which our catabolic enzymes easily break down. We just add the water molecule back in a process called hydrolysis. Or we can make a bond called a beta-glycosidic bond. These bonds are much harder for us to break down. If we use our condensation reactions to put a bunch of sugars together, we form a carbohydrate. A typical example of a carbohydrate is glycogen. Glycogen is the storage form for glucose in animals. When we have excess glucose, we store it. By using glycogenesis, we take that glucose and make it into glycogen. When we need glucose, we can just reverse the reaction. Take the glycogen, break it back down into glucose. That process is called glycogenolysis. Yes, you actually need to know those chemical reactions. Those are used repeatedly in upcoming chapters. Starch is also an example of a carbohydrate. It has the same function, storage of glucose, but in plants, not animals. Another important carbohydrate is cellulose. Plants use cellulose to make cell walls. Molecules like cellulose use beta bonds between the sugars. These are not easily broken down. In nutrition, this type of molecule is called dietary fiber. We need a mix of soluble and insoluble fiber in our diets. Fiber is really important. It can help you lower your blood cholesterol. It can reduce your blood sugar spikes after eating. It can help reduce your risk of breast cancer and colon rectal cancers. It can help with weight control because it makes you feel full, helps you prevent overeating. And it's important to avoid constipation. Chronic constipation can lead to health issues like anal fissures, anal fistulas, and diverticulitis. When we think about fiber, we may think about whole wheat. But do you really know what that means? You may have saying about amber waves of grain, but have you ever actually looked at a wheat grain? A kernel of wheat is a seed from which a new wheat plant can grow. There's 3 components. The germ is the actual embryo. It's really high in vitamins and minerals. It's separated during the process of making flour and not used in flour because it's about 10% fat, which shortens the shelf life of the flour. Wheat germ can be purchased separately, though, as a food supplement. Another part is the endosperm. This is the source for the actual white flour. It does have protein, carbs, vitamins, minerals, and some soluble fiber in it. The proteins in there are called prolamins, and they include gluten. You may have heard of celiac disease and or gluten sensitivity. Those conditions are related to this protein. The bran is the outermost coat of the wheat kernel. It has insoluble fiber along with other nutrients. Whole wheat flour includes the bran. So if you noticed, soluble and insoluble fiber are found only in plant-based foods. Today, sometimes people go on low-carb weight loss diets without following a nutritionist's advice. They end up eating just meat and cheese and eggs. If you follow a nutritionist's advice about these programs, they're actually going to include some plant-based foods, ones that are low in sugars but high in complex carbohydrates like fiber, foods such as flax seeds, almonds, pecans, blackberries, spinach, asparagus. You get the idea. This chapter also reviews the digestion of carbohydrates and absorption of the sugars. Absorption of sugars increases the blood sugar levels. That increase is called a glycemic response. You'll be looking at that along with glycemic index and glycemic load. Related to blood sugar levels, you'll study how insulin stimulates the uptake of glucose from the blood and glycogenesis, and how glucagon stimulates gluconeogenesis and the release of glucose from the blood. I hope you really enjoy the carbs chapter. Contact me if you have questions.